You're all set now for the second lecture of Yin Van Lee. Let me just add here for all the participants that Yin's last lecture has been uploaded on the website. Anyone who is interested to get these slides, so they can go to the webpage of the Simpa School, our official webpage. So you can access from there. And again, I am reminding here that all the video recording has been uploaded there. And there is an advice too. Please do download those videos, because definitely these are cloud recordings. So once you download, so it will be saved with you for future references. But definitely that is not available for the lifetime there. I hope you understand this, that cloud saving. Okay, now we are moving towards the second lecture of Den. Over to you, Den, now.
Yeah, okay, so thanks. Yeah, so today, I will, as promised, I will present the proof of Wyman-Minkowski theorem. I present the proof of this theorem. First of all, this is a fundamental theorem, and secondly, the proof. In the proof, I will introduce some useful technique. Yeah, so that is the reason why we spend the whole lecture for the proof of one theorem. Okay, so let me first recall the theorem. Yeah, so we have two versions of Wyman-Minkowski, one for polytope and one for cone. Yeah, okay, so for polytopes, Wyman-Minkowski theorem says that a polytope is nothing but the convex span of a finite set. So, okay, so I mean, here by definition, a polytope, so we call that a polytope is a intersection of the half space, right? So half space, here you have half space. Yeah, so today I try some other software so that I can write a little bit. So here you have some half space. Okay. So here a polytope is a bounded polyhedron, and it is defined by a finitely many half spaces. So the theorem say that you can either determine this polytope by it by this subspace by this half spaces, or by its vertices. By this vertices, so the one I make the circle here. Yeah, so that is the statement for of the theorem for polytope. You can either determine a polytope by subspaces, by half spaces or by vertices. And these two notions, the vertices and this facet, this facet are dual to each other. And similarly for cone, we have a similar characterization. A cone can be either determined by linear half spaces or by race, by race. So for example, so something like this, and imagine that you have a cone like this. Yeah, so so this cone can be either determined by this linear half spaces or by this ray. So let me write it in another color. So this ray. So this cone has three rays. So yeah, can be either determined by half spaces or by ray, and actually the ray and these faces of the cone are dual to each other. You can see later. Okay, so here's the outline of the proof. okay, so first of all, the two versions of the theorem are in fact equivalent. And I let this set that this as an exercise. So the idea is that if you have a polytope here, so for example P in R to the N, then you can consider a cone CP in R to the N plus one. So this is the cone generated by this point. Cone generated by this point x1 with x belong to P. So imagine that so here you have a polytope and then you consider this cone. So something like this. So you have P here and then you consider this cone CP. So whenever you prove the theorem for cones, then you can immediately imply it for the polytopes. Good. Okay. So the Wyminkowski theorem in fact consists of two parts. Yeah, one part is the Y theorem, which say that every finitely generated conical set is a polyhedral cone. Yeah, so this is the implication from 2 to 1 in the theorem. And to prove this implication, we will use Fourier-Moskin elimination. So this is a similar. This is a similarity of Gaussian elimination that you may know already from linear algebra. And the other implication is Minkowski theorem. Yeah, so we say that every polyhedral cone is finitely generated, and to prove this implication, we will use duality. Yeah, so I mean the. So to prove this theorem, we will use these two very useful techniques, Fourier-Moskin elimination and duality. Yeah, so that is one of the reasons that that I spend this talk to give the proof of the theorem. Good. So okay. So before coming to Fourier-Moskin elimination theorem. So let me start with an example. So here I have a system of linear inequality. Yeah, and so you imagine that you have a linear programming problem, and you have to check whether this is feasible or not. Yeah, so here you have to decide whether this linear system of equation, linear system of inequality is solvable. So then, I will let you a minute to think about this exercise. So do you have any idea how to check whether this system is solvable or not? Cannot see the chat. Where is this?
but it's there in the chat.
So because I'm using another software, so I cannot see the chat. So if
please continue.
Okay. Okay. So I mean the idea here is it's very similar to Gaussian elimination to solve a linear system of equation. So to decide this, whether this system is solvable or not, we perform elementary Rolle's operation, but here we only perform non-negative Rolle operation. Okay, so I mean the idea is that if you have this inequality a1x smaller than b1, yeah, and a2x smaller than b2, then you will have lambda 1 a1x plus lambda 2 a2x smaller than lambda 1 b1 plus lambda 2 b2 whenever lambda 1 and lambda 2 are non-negative, right? So yeah, so that is the only operation that we allow here to perform Rolle's operation.
Just to preserve the inequalities so that the solution should the Rolle operation should not spoil.
Sorry, can you repeat it?
Okay, please continue.
Yeah, okay, so I mean because we want to keep the inequality, right? So to have a correct operation, then here we only allow lambda 1 and lambda 2 are non-negative. Yeah, so okay, so now let's take the coefficient matrices of this system. The coefficient matrix of this system, and so okay, so for example, here we would like to eliminate the last variable. We want to eliminate this variable x3. Okay, so then here we have two negative coefficients. Then if you want to eliminate this coefficient, then with non-negative operation, then you have to add some multiple of this Rolle with some multiple of the Rolle with positive coefficient, right? So okay, so here first, for example, I take this Rolle, I multiply 3 times this Rolle, and then I add the second Rolle. I add 2 times of the second Rolle. Yeah, so then I get this one. Okay. Similarly, I take this Rolle. Yeah, 1 time this Rolle, and I add 2 times the third Rolle. Then I get this one. Okay, and now the last Rolle, I take the last Rolle, multiply it 3 times, and then I add the second Rolle. Yeah, so then I get this one. And finally, the third Rolle, I add with the last Rolle, and then I get this one. So then I get, I have eliminate the last variable, yeah, by using non-negative Rolle's operation. Good. And now I continue to eliminate the second variable. Yeah, similarly, I can do similarly as before. So here I have one negative coefficient and three positive coefficient. So then let's add this one with the add the first row with the second row, I guess this one. And then I add the first row with the third row, that's this one, and the first row with the last one, I get this one. Good. Okay, so I have eliminated the third and the second variable, and in the last step, I will eliminate the first variable. So here I have minus three. Yeah, so so for example, I take three times the first row and I add 10 times the second row. So I get this one, and take four times the second row, add three times the last row, I get this one. Okay, so now I have eliminated all the variable, and here we see that the last system is solvable. All right, so the last system is its equivalent. So the last system is nothing but 0x1 plus 0x2 plus 0x3 smaller than 30, and similarly smaller than 15. So this this system is solvable. So the given one is also solvable. So one can show that the last system is solvable if and only if the given one is solvable. So by performing this non-negative row operation. Yeah, so that is the main idea of Fourier-Mosphin elimination. So now if we state this technique formally, we can state this technique as the theorem Fourier-Mosphin elimination. So now you consider this system of linear inequality. You have a matrix A and a vector B, and you consider this system of inequality. So Fourier-Mosphin elimination say that you can eliminate any variable in this system by using non-negative rows operation, as I perform already in the example. Yeah, so formally this say that whenever you have this system and you have an index of a column index, so it is correspond to one variable in this system, then you can find a non-negative matrix U such that the J column of this product is zero. Yeah, so this is this product U multiplied with A, this is equivalent to some set of rows operation. And the given system is solvable if and only if the new system, this new system, so you multiply U into both sides of the given system, is solvable. Yeah, as we saw already in the example, you can iteratively apply this elimination to bring the given system to a system of this form, zero multiply x smaller than some b prime, right? And then this system is solvable if and only if the given system is solvable. Yeah, so that is the corollary that I state here. So whenever you have a linear system, a system of linear inequality, then you can use Fourier-Mosphin elimination to eliminate all the variable in the system. Yeah, so until you have a system of this form, and the last system is solvable if and only if the given system is solvable. Yes, and I mean checking the, whether this system it is solvable, it is very easy, right? Because you have a system with the in one side you only have a zero, and in the other side you have a vector. So you only have to check whether all the coordinates of this vector are non-negative or not. So this is somehow it is rather similar to Gaussian elimination, but it can be used to check whether a system of linear inequality solvable or not. Okay, so any questions so far?
So is there any condition on the jth column in the sense that what you explained in the previous example, then there should be some...
No. You can choose J arbitrarily. So as we say here in the theorem, J can be any column index. So you can choose J can be,
If I look this U from the previous example, so this U is particularly the matrix of the row operations on the elementary matrix. It is an elementary matrix.
You mean this one?
Yeah, for this particular matrix, which gives me, which determines the row operations, right?
U is just given by the rows operation. So here, yeah. I mean, so here, for example, you take the first row, you add the second row, right? So you take this row, you add this row, so it corresponds to multiply mm-hmm. this matrix with some matrix U here. Right, so this is just a rows operation, but here the only difference is that we only allowed non-negative coefficient.
I completely understand. And so when we talk about the existence of the solution, then there can exist such a U which can be multiplied in this way so that all the variable columns should vanish, right?
Yeah. So here, I mean, if you apply this process, this elimination process, iteratively, so first you choose some J and then you choose another J. After M time, then you will come up to
this B. Okay. Now it's okay.
Good. Okay, so now let's apply this one to a system that is closer to a conical set. Yeah. Okay. So now let's apply Gaussian Fourier Mosepin elimination to solve a system of this form. So I mean, a system of this form is nothing but a conical set. So we will see it in a minute. Good. Okay. So now I consider this system Ax equal to y, and x is non-negative. So this corollary says that this system is solvable. Yeah, so the set of all y such that this system is solvable so there exists a metric B. There exists a metric B such that the set of y, the set of the vector y such that this system is solvable can be written in this form. B times y is non-negative. okay, so then we can just apply the previous corollary, because this system can be equivalently written in this form, Ax equal to y, then you can write this equality in terms of true inequality. So ax smaller than y, then and minus ax smaller than minus y, and x non-negative can be equivalently written as minus x smaller than zero, right? So then we write this system in the form that we can apply the previous corollary, right? So you can write this system in this form. Okay, so here EM is, this is the identity matrix. Okay, so now this system, so the given, so this system is solvable if and only if this one is solvable, yeah, because they are equivalent. And okay, so then by the previous corollary, so by this corollary, you can find a non-negative matrix. B bar. So here I write B1, B2, B3 because okay. So imagine that this is the y is in the Rn minus y is again in Rn, and here zero is in Rm, right? So here B1 is a metric of this. Form, so maybe k times n, b2 is k times n, and b3 is k times n, yeah. So yeah, so I mean that's a clearly way to write this metric b bar, so that we can multiply this metric with this vector. Okay, so this system is solvable if and only if B bar, so here B bar is B1, B2, B3, B bar here, B bar, sorry, B, B bar, B, B bar here times this vector y minus y zero. Yeah, so this is B1, B2, B3 times y minus y zero. So then here you get nothing but B1 minus B2 y. Okay, and the given system is solvable if and only if this one is non-negative. So okay, so then we have this equality. The set of y, so that this system is solvable, this is can be described equivalently in this form. So it is exactly the set of all vector y such that b times y is non-negative. Yeah. So here what b? So here b, you can choose b to be b1 minus b2. Okay. So that is that is an application of Fourier Muskin elimination, and so that application is exactly what we want to prove Y theorem. So Y theorem say that if we have a finitely generated conical set, then this is a cone, this is a polyhedral cone, right? A finitely generated conical set, so this is by definition, this is cone of um so this is from last time we know that this is exactly the set of all the conical combination of U1 to UM. Yeah, so here lambda I non-negative, right? So an element of this cone an element of this cone always have this form. So it can be written as a conical combination of U1 to UM. So yeah, so then this means that if you take A to be the metric with column U1 to UM, then C, the cone C, the conical set C is exactly the set of the vector Y, so that this system is solvable, right? Because Y belong to C means that there exists non-negative lambda I, so that Y is lambda 1 U1 plus until lambda N U N. Yeah, so this conical set is exactly the set of all vector Y, so that this system is solvable. Okay, and then in the previous corollary, we saw that this set is exactly, so this set can be written in this form. So there exists a metric B such that the conical set C is exactly this set. And okay, I mean this set is exactly a linear system of inequality, right? So this is a linear system of inequality, and so this is that's an intersection of linear half spaces, and by definition, C is a polyhedral cone. Okay, so that is Weyl theorem. So okay, so then as you saw, Weyl theorem is somehow a rather direct consequence of Fourier-Moskin elimination. Okay, so any question?
For every solvable set, we have this structure of polyhedral cone, right?
Yeah.
Because there exists a matrix P which is giving the structure of cone.
Yeah, right. Good, okay, so now let's move on to prove the other direction. So to prove the other direction, then we need the notion of duality. Okay, so here if I have a subset K of R to the N, then I define the dual cone of K to be this set, yeah, so the set of all the vector X such that the scalar multiplication of X and U is non-negative for all the vector U in K. So here, I mean, this scalar multiplication is nothing but, so if U is this vector U1 to UN and X is X1 to XN, then this scalar multiplication I recall is U1 X1 plus until UN XN. Yeah, I hope that you know this notion already. Yeah, so the dual of K is the set of all the vector X such that this scalar product is non-negative for all the vector, for all the element U in K. So the dual cone of K is its own way a cone. Even the K is any subset of
U belonging to K which is Rn.
Okay. Yeah, K can be convex or non-convex, or yeah, I mean any subset in R to the N. But it's dual. It's its own way a cone. So this explains the name dual cone, because K star is just an intersection of linear half space, right? So the vector the set of the vector X such that this scalar product, it is non-negative, this is a linear half space, right? So then K star is that's an intersection of linear half space. So this is always a cone. Yeah, so I mean here are some very easy example. So if you take the dual of the zero vector, yeah.
So it contains the orthogonal complement of U, right? Okay.
So in the case that K is a linear subspace of H, R to the N, then K star is exactly the orthogonal complement. You write that if you take the orthogonal complement, then for sure it is so I mean the notion of orthogonal complement is only makes sense when K is a subspace of R to the N, right? And in that case K star is exactly the orthogonal complement, because so now here, because for a linear subspace, whenever you have U belong to K, then minus U also belong to K, right? So then you have U transpose X is non-negative, and you also have minus U transpose multiplied with X is non-negative. So from here you get that this one must be zero. So yeah. If you take the non-negative octane, then the dual of the non-negative octane is the non-negative octane itself. Good. So this is one the important theorem, the duality theorem. So we describe the dual of a polyhedral cone. Yeah, so if you have a polyhedral cone, which is given by this linear half space, yeah, I times X is non-negative, then the dual cone of C is exactly the cone that is generated by the row vector of this matrix A. This is what I said from the beginning. If you have if you consider cone something like this, so here if you consider a polyhedral cone, then this cone this cone is by definition this is determined by this linear half spaces, yeah, and it this linear half spaces is given by each of this linear half spaces is given by linear inequality, one homogeneous linear inequality of this form, right? And the Wyminkowski theorem say this cone can also be determined by this ray, so here the duality theorem say that two points of that two viewpoints are in fact dual to each other. So here if you have a polyhedral cone defined by this inequality, then the dual cone is exactly the cone generated by this vector. Yeah, so the vector that determine the faces of the polyhedral cone C here. Okay, and another important statement of the duality theorem is that the double dual of C is equal to C itself. So if you take the dual of C and then take again the dual of this dual, then you get back C. Yeah, so that is one nice statement. So maybe I guess similar phenomenon happened in several other area of mathematics, right? So maybe when you have a vector space, then you take a double dual, then it is again the isomorphic to the vector space. Yeah, so in linear algebra and also in topology and some other field mathematics, we have some similar situation. Okay, so let's give a quick proof. Well, yeah, so here's the kind of proof. So first of all, we always have this inclusion. Yeah, because if you take X in C, then this means that U transpose X is non-negative for all U in C star. Okay, but U transpose X is also X transpose times U. So then this means that X transpose U is non-negative for all U in C star. And then by definition, this means that X belongs to C double star. Yeah, so then we always have this inclusion. And okay, so then, and also by definition, you have that U1 to UM are element of C star because the so AX is this A times X. This is nothing but U1X, UMX, right? So because this vector is non-negative, so this means that all of its component are non-negative. So U1 to UM are element of C star. Okay, so now we use definition. C double star is this intersection. Yeah, so the intersection of all of this half space where U run in C star. But C star contain U1 to UM. So then this intersection must be contained in this intersection, right? The intersection of X, so that UI transpose times X is non-negative for I running from 1 to M. Okay, but this by definition, this is exactly X, such that AX is non-negative, right? Because the UI X is a component of the vector A times X. So okay, so then this is by definition, this is the C. Okay, so then from here, we conclude that C and C double star are the same. Good. Okay, so for the first statement, I denote by C hat the conical set, the conical hull of U1 to UM. Yeah, and I have to show that this C hat is exactly C star. Okay, so first of all, C hat by its definition, this is a finitely generated conical set. And we saw already that C hat is a subset of C star. And C hat star is C. Right, C hat star is, again, by definition, C hat star, you can check that, that's by definition, that C hat star is C. Okay, so C hat is this a conical set, finitely generate the conical set. So by Weyl theorem, we know that C hat is a polyhedral cone. Yeah, so Weyl theorem say that C hat is a polyhedral cone. So then from the second part of the duality theorem, from the second part of the dual, so from the second part that we have just proved, C hat is equal to C hat double star. Okay, but now here we know that C hat star is C. C hat star is C, so then C hat is nothing but C star. Okay. So yeah, so then yeah, I mean this is somehow a concrete description of the dual set of a polyhedral cone. And now I mean by using this duality theorem, then we can easily prove the Minkowski theorem, which say that any polyhedral cone is finitely generated.
Regarding to the duality theorem, so this is concluded that if a cone is determined by the matrix A,
yeah,
so its dual cone is going to be determined by matrix A transpose, right?
So that is. That it I mean that is some that is some if here I mean here if you say that determine means
AX is greater or equal to zero.
So here I mean this one is not so C star is not equal to X such that this is not correct. I mean formally you can see that because the for example, here A is M by N matrix, right? So then,
yeah, it is X times A transpose greater equal to zero.
M by N matrix. Then A transpose is something like N by M, right? Matrix. So then, this set, So this set is something in the RM. So I mean formally it's not the same, but here I mean determine if you use the term of Minkowski theorem, so you use the term determine in the sense that you can determine a cone by either its faces or by its rays. So here the duality theorem say that if a cone C is given by this is described by this faces, right? So if you know the faces of the cone C, then you know the ray of the dual cone. So you know the faces of C, yeah. So the faces of C are given by some hyperplane, right? Then the coefficient, the vector consists of the coefficient of that hyperplane are exactly the rays of the dual cone.
So regarding to the C star, the dual cone, whether there will be some matrix too, which is determining it.
Yes, but
and that matrix has nothing to do with A, right?
It has something to do with A, but is it not so explicit that we can see immediately? So I mean, it is for sure not A transpose. It is for sure not A transpose. So I mean, For example, by using by using some method, and then you can find a metric, some metric B. Yeah? So as we did in the Fourier-Moskvin theorem, right? So whenever you have a conical set, then there exists a metric B such that this one is exactly Y, such that B Y is non-negative, right? So this metric B can be computed, but it is not explicit. It is not immediately. It is not explicit for me that I can immediately written here.
Okay, so I mean, if we work in a standard setting where A is a square matrix and we are given with n rows and column, then still there is no connection with A, and A transpose are not determining the dual.
No. So I mean, of course there are connection, but this is not explicit as far as I understand. So I mean, at least you have to do Fourier-Moskvin elimination to compute this metric B.
Okay, thank you.
Oh, yeah, thanks. Okay, so then now we can prove Minkowski theorem, right? So here's the scatter proof. So if you have a polynomial cone C, then this is finitely generated. So the idea is that to turn to the dual cone. So the duality theorem say that C star is a finitely generated conical set, right? So then by Weyl theorem, C star is a polyhedral cone. And now because C equal to dual of C star, yeah? And so then again by duality theorem, because this is a polyhedral, this is a polyhedral cone. So so then the C by duality theorem apply to C star, then we imply again that C must be a finitely generated conical set. Yeah, so I mean then basically Minkowski theorem follow from the duality theorem and Weyl theorem. Okay, and one, okay, so then one interesting corollary of Weyl-Minkowski theorem is that a cone is finitely generated if and only if its dual is also finitely generated. So I mean this point of view will be used in the last talk. Yeah, so in the last talk by team, so team will discuss this viewpoint of why Minkowski theorem in finite dimensional situation. So in our extension of the why Minkowski theorem to infinite dimensional case. Good. Okay. So then, yesterday I said that there's one interesting consequence of Weyl-Minkowski theorem is that whenever you have two cone or two polytope, then their Minkowski sum is again a cone or polytope. And so here, a more specific description of Minkowski sum of two conical or two convex set. Yeah, so whenever you have two convex set, then their Minkowski sum can be explicit described in this form, and also for the cone, we also have an explicit description. Yeah, so then from this description and then from Minkowski white theorem, we see immediately that the cone, the Minkowski sum of two polytope or two cone is again a polytope or a cone. And yeah, so for example here, if you want to compute the Minkowski sum of these two polytopes, then you only need to consider the vertexes of these two polytopes. Yeah, so this one is exactly the convex hand of x y plus y j. So here x I in p and y j in q. So if you you take the vertices of this p and take the vertices of q, then the Minkowski sum is nothing but the convex hand of these vertices. Good. Okay. So yeah, I think time is up. So let me summarize what we have done today. So okay. So as we saw already, the Fourier Moskvin elimination. This is an algorithm to check the solvability of a system of linear inequality. Yeah, and we use this to prove white theorem. And duality, it appears in many fields of mathematics, and it's a useful technique. And today we use this to verify Minkowski theorem. Okay, and finally, I just want to emphasize this point of view of why Minkowski theorem. A cone is finitely generated if and only if its dual is finitely generated. Okay, and okay, so then for the proof, for the proof of that I sketch, you can find further detail in this reference. So maybe this one, and yeah, this one. Good. Okay, so then I could stop here. Thanks very much for the attention. And if you have any questions,
keep the reference. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you very much, Dean. Are there any questions from the audience? Maybe firstly, Numan, is there something in the chat box? Nothing. Okay.
Chat box. Yeah.
There is no. Is there some questions from the IBA Karachi? Okay. May you please elaborate what do you mean by finitely generated cone in the sense in the context you are explaining AX greater or equal to, again I'm struck by this.
Finitely generated means that C can be written as a cone of finitely many rays, right? So this is the lambda I u I from 1 to n. Yeah, so here lambda I non-negative. So finitely generated means this. So if you have finitely many rays.
So is it possible that for instance in R3 we can have an infinitely generated cone too? Because definitely we can't have is there some condition on U1 and UM they need to be independent or sort of?
No. This is so. I mean, in at least in this form, U1 and UN can be arbitrary.
Any point.
But I mean, if you want to have a redundant representation, then for example in R2, right? So if you have three rays like this, then this ray is for sure belong to the conical belong to the conical hand of these two rays, right? So then this one is super plus, and you don't need this one in this representation. right? So, but I mean, in this representation, we do not say anything about irredundant of U1.
Yeah,
or,
we can't drop just like yeah. configuration. Can yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Right.
Okay. Okay. There is some question in IBA from IBA Karachi on mic. Okay, you are on air now from IBA Karachi. Please go ahead.
Assalamu alaikum.
Gigi, we can hear you. Continue.
So I have a question that can we draw the cone C and C star for the example that we have solved before?
I don't hear very well. So Imran, can you repeat the...
She said, is it possible to see a cone and its dual through a sketching diagram? So probably for a simple example, for the cone and its dual, can you sketch it for a particular example?
Okay. So let me come to some place where I have more. I hope that I can. Good. Okay, so first of all, then for sure you in R2, then for sure if you take R2 non-negative, right? So this one, R2 non-negative, then we saw already that the dual of this one is nothing but R2 non-negative, right? The dual of the non-negative often of R2 is the non-negative part again. But let me now take another example. So for example, take this cone, consider this cone, okay? Let's take another. So maybe then the dual of this one, so then you, for the dual of this one, then you take something that is perpendicular.
Orthogonal complement of it.
Yeah, this one. And so this is orthogonal to this ray. And now you take another ray that is orthogonal to the other ray. Right? So this one, it, so maybe this is R1. So this is ray 2. So this is R1 star and this is R2 star. Yeah, so then if you take this is C, I'm sorry, C is this blue cone, then C star is this the red cone here. Right? So you take one ray that perpendicular to the other ray, and then you take the cone generated by these two rays. Is that clear?
Yeah. There is a question from here. Why can we take R1 square on the same side of R2? So can we extend this? You understand the orthogonality allows.
Okay.
Instead of taking R1 star in the fourth quadrant, can we take R1 star in the second quadrant?
Yes. So. So you mean not taking this one, but maybe taking this one, right?
No. The dual. Oh, sorry. Orthogonal complement of R2.
R2. Okay. So.
Okay. And R1. Sorry. Orthogonal complement of R1. Can we take the ray inside the second quadrant instead of the fourth quadrant?
You mean this line or
just sketch R1, just sketch R1 vector.
This one or
R1 in the example you are drawing. In your example, just sketch R1.
Just sketch R1. Okay. Okay. So then, this is not a good system. Oh, sorry. Okay, so let me draw.
Sketch R1, only R1. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. So
now,
you have
if you take its orthogonal complement. Now take its orthogonal complement with some other color. Some other color.
Yeah. Some other color. Good.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Just go to the road. Go to your previous sketching now. Instead of taking R1 star downward, can we take R1 star upward on the somewhere in the second quadrant too?
R1 star, it should be like this, right? So
this direction.
But then if you take the intersection of these two half space, then you get to this part, right? So if you take the intersection of these two half space, then only a cone is left, right? So if you take this one and maybe something like this, the left is one cone, right? So this is...
In either case, the cone will be the same.
Yeah. So this cone. Yeah. Sorry. So this is I'm not good at writing. And...
is there any other question? I think.
Hello. Hello.
Yeah. Please speak. We can hear you.
We use here finitely generated cones. Can you explain what are infinitely generated cones?
Finitely generated cone mean then can be determined by two points. So if you increase the points, geometrically, can you explain what is the finitely generated cone?
A finitely generated cone means that. So here you have
give an example of infinitely generated cone.
Particularly give him the example of infinitely generated cone.
Okay. Yeah, so for example R and non-negative, right? So this is the cone that is generated by E1, E2 to EN. Yeah, so for example, here in R2, then this one is a finitely generated cone. But this one is not. So I mean, if you take the positive part, the non-negative part is finitely generated. But you take only the positive part. So if you remove the axis, then this one is not finitely generated. This cone is not finitely generated, right? So if you remove the axis of the non-negative cone, then this is not finitely generated. So finitely generated means that there exist finitely many
points.
Many points such that the conical hull is equal to the cone. So here, imagine that in R2, then you only take the positive part. You take only the positive part without the axis. Then this one is not finitely generated, right?
Yeah.
Because if you take one point, then there only one. Yeah, if you take finitely many points, then there only some points that lie outside the cone generated by those points.
Yeah, thank you. आप लोगों को समझ आ गई IPA Karachi?
Yeah.
Yeah, मैं explain करूँ थोड़ा सा. Okay, जो इन्होंने example दिया अगर इसमें ये जो first quadrant वाला है तो आप कोई end point pick नहीं कर सकते जो कि इसको generate कर रहा हो.
Yes, yeah.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much for these elaborations and for very wonderful lecture.
Yeah.
So please do share. Don't forget to share. Slides and everything.
Sure. Yeah. Okay.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Thank you. Now there is a break. We will resume at 2:30 when Sara Madani will be having a tutorial. There is another question. I'm sorry.
Okay. Yeah. No problem.
Okay, my question is, if we consider a circular cone, its VD, which means that the trace of that cone is an ellipse or a circle. So, is this the case of infinitely generated cone?
What do you mean by tail?
My question is, if we consider a circular cone, which means that the trace of that cone is an ellipse or a circle.
सर्कुलर कोन का यहाँ पे हम इसको डिस्कस करेंगे थोड़ा सा बाद में, क्योंकि द मेन थिंग इज दैट के सर्कुलर कोन कांट बी अटेन. ये बिल्कुल, अगर इस चीज को देखना है ना, तो आप इस पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू से देखिएगा कि जैसे एक वेक्टर होता है, आप उसका स्पैनिंग लेते हैं, स्पैनिंग जैसे एक सिंगल वेक्टर की होती है, लेकिन उसमें आप सिर्फ पॉजिटिव कोफिशिएंट अलाउ करते हैं. सो यू हैव द स्पैनिंग ओनली इन द पॉजिटिव डायरेक्शन. तो जब भी आप 2 पॉइंट से या 3 पॉइंट से या 5 पॉइंट से जब भी लेंगे, आपके पास नहीं आएगी. सर्कुलर कोन सिर्फ एक ही केस में बन सकती है कि अगर आप R3 में जाएं और इनफिनिटली मेनी पॉइंट लें जो तकरीबन सर्कल पे लाई कर रहे हैं, यू अंडरस्टैंड, एंड देन उनका स्पैन लें R3 के अंदर, इट विल क्रिएट अ सर्कुलर कोन, लेकिन दैट विल बी एन इनफिनिटली जनरेटेड कोन. दैट इज एन एग्जांपल ऑफ अ सर्कुलर कोन. आई होप यू अंडरस्टैंड द पॉइंट. Finitely generated circular cone या elliptic cone की example नहीं हो सकती. So that is do you understand everything? अगर नहीं है तो इसको हम बाद में discuss करेंगे problem solving session में. Okay. There is a question in the audience, Jen. Please.
Yes. Am I audible? No.
Now try. Hello, yeah. Am I audible? Yeah. So for our definition of the Minkowski sum, do P and Q have to be polygons, or can we take for the sum of, for example, a polygon and a disk?
Can you repeat your question once again so that elaborative?
So for the Minkowski sum, we've defined the Minkowski sum between P and Q. Minkowski sum for P and Q, and so the examples we've discussed were for specifically for polygons, the addition of two polygons. Can we add objects that are non-polygons? So, like for example, if we take the Minkowski sum of a polygon and a disk.
Yesterday I think I described already the Minkowski sum of a circle and a line and a circle and a triangle, right? So, basically, the Minkowski sum can be defined for any two subset of R to the n. So, it is thus the set consisting of all the sum of one element in P and one element in Q. So, you can define it for any two subset of R to the n.
Yeah.
But the thing is that if you have two polytopes, then their sum is again a polytope, or if you have two cones, then their sum is again a cone. Yeah, so that is one corollary of Minkowski theorem.
We can see Professor Jorge with us. Hi, Jorge. Numan, allow him to unmute.
Hello. Yes, I can hear you.
So, did you arrive safely?
Yes, perfectly. Thank you very much.
You got settled.
No
now.
Problem. Okay. I cannot connect every time because, well, at the beginning, the first session is too early in Spain, and I don't want to connect, let's say, at 5 a.m., something like this. But okay. I shall be connected sometimes. I will connect, for instance, for the the closure session at the on Friday. But if not, I will connect to some lectures. I will be connecting.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Now this is a break time. Good to see you, Jorge.
Nice to see you again. Yes.
Okay. Now we will resume at 2:30. Everyone, please be here. And there is a small announcement that at 2:30 we have the tutorial by Sara Madani. And at the end of that tutorial, before the tea, we will be having a small celebration of the International Day of Women's. There will be a cake cutting ceremony and in recognition of the women who are our colleagues and who came here to attend the Simpa School, all our participants. And IBA Karachi, you can join these celebrations too through virtually. And similarly, we have among us Kai Kupchas, so who is a representative of European Women Mathematical Association. So please join the celebration at 3:30 as well. Okay, thank you, everyone. Thank you. We will resume at 2:30.